Though the name conjures the image of a loving grandmother, the force behind it is far from being one. Loving, yes, but Lola, she isn't. Forged by the heat of the kitchen, fortified by the steady guidance of her parents, Steffi Santana has emerged to be an entrepreneurial icon of the new generation. But it wasn't all easy. See, almost a decade into pounding the pavement while building the brand, it was only when the world stopped, when Lola Nenas found its momentum. During the pandemic, those red and white checkered boxes found its way to frontliners and patients and relatives missed and friends never to be forgotten. They became hugs and kisses and love sent in every box received. Lola Nenas now has 28 branches, and Steffi, well, she's not done yet. Mga apo, let's bring her in. Steffi Santana, one of the remarkable women we honor this month. Steffi, hi.
Hi.
Welcome to the program.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
And happy Women's Month to you.
Happy Women's Month to you, too.
All right. So let's begin with the fact that an international clothing brand is actually featuring you this month as one of the women that they celebrate. How awesome is that? And how did that happen?
I've always thought of myself as a leader, but never necessarily a woman leader. But I think this month, having that collaboration with Uniqlo being here, it kind of has made me think of myself as a woman leader and really embrace the values that we have as women. Mm-hmm. The values that we have as women really parallels the values we have in Lola Nenas. Love, care, warmth, respect. It's kind of what a Lola is all about. It's kind of how we are women is all about. So yeah, it's nice. It feels really good to be.
So it's only until recently when you realized that.
It's because I've just always I've never really looked at
gender
as much. Mm-hmm. Of course, we feel that growing up, we know we're women, but in a position of quote unquote power in a company, I've always thought of myself as equal as everybody else. Mm-hmm. But collaborating with Uniqlo, being here now, I kind of am championing being a woman more and really embracing the values that we have. I mean, we are here because of our values.
And talk to us about those values, because yeah. When you were in the States, yeah. You were bussing tables, you were front desk, you were receiving customers and all that. You would clean tables as well,
yeah.
when your customers would finish their meals in your family-owned restaurant.
Bus the dishes,
exactly.
Wash the dishes.
Correct. So when I said you were fortified, you're strengthened by you know the heat of the kitchen and all that. Tell us about the values that you learned there, and what was the guiding force from your parents? Because you guys, it's family owned, yes.
Yeah.
But they could have gotten someone else, but you were part of it.
Yeah. There's something growing up in the States and really working in the service industry and going through being a waitress, a busboy, cooking in the kitchen. There is a level of hard work that you really go through. And I think going through that and then the first 10 years of Lola Nenas, really preparing for this big break that we had in 2020. Of course, you don't know if a big break is ever going to come.
Exactly.
But every day you're working hard, thinking that one day this is going to all this work is going to make sense. Mm-hmm. And the break is going to come. And then when it comes, we're going to go all in. Mm-hmm. That prepared me. All of that prepared me from 2020. In 2020, we had 60 employees. 2023, 600 plus.
Oh, that's amazing.
So it's a 10-year of like a slow preparation, and then overnight it flips. Mm. And then you just have to be prepared. Mm.
But what was the decision? Why did you have to go back to the motherland?
And when I was
Lola Nenas even part of
no,
the
not
process?
No, when I was younger, my dad did an autobiography on his dad. I never met my grandfather, so he passed away before I was born. But in the autobiography, my grandfather said, as Filipinos, you can go around the world, learn what you can, study, but at some point you have to go back and give back. And I think my dad had that in him. He knew at some point he was going to come back. And me watching that autobiography, I knew that some point we were going to come back. Mm. We just weren't sure how we were going to give back. But I guess now it's really creating a service for our customers, but also creating a really good workspace for the people that work for us, and being a company that champions its people. Mm. So that's kind of exciting on our end. We feel like that's one of our callings, is really to create more jobs and create jobs that people actually like.
Mm-hmm. And you see that on your posts, right?
Yeah.
They're happy. They're happy going to work.
Yeah, I hope so.
Well, I see it,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
And it's just so happy when you see all those boxes. But first, how did Lola Nenas come about? I mean, was that something that you were working on? Was that in its incubation stage and for how long?
When we first moved to the Philippines in 2012, we actually opened another restaurant. And my dad assigned me to really handle that restaurant, create the branding. And I thought I knew what I was doing. I was 21 years old. Mm. I thought I knew what I was doing, but I really didn't. And when that restaurant closed within a year, I felt really defeated. And my dad said, "Are you sure kaya mo maging entrepreneur? We fail a lot in this line of work." Mm-hmm. And so that was kind of like a click for me that, wait, it's okay to fail. And so we thought, okay, what are the things that we learned in the past year in this failed business? And that's where we made Lola Nenas. Mm-hmm. Our first ever branch was a really small branch in Quezon Ave. Mm-hmm. And yes, it was a slow growth, but after 10 years, it blossomed.
And why Lola Nenas? Your Lola Nena in particular?
So we were thinking of a name for our new Peachy Peachy brand. We only had Peachy Peachy back then. And mm-hmm. we wanted it to feel Filipino. We wanted it to feel homey. We wanted it to feel like when customers come in, they feel the comfort. Mm-hmm. And you were thinking, okay, what matches that? What else matches that better but a Lola?
And a Lola's hug, and a Lola's korot, and a Lola's,
yeah,
you know,
and
giggle.
You know, when you're in your Lola's house, no matter what, you're safe.
Yes.
And that's the feeling that we wanted to put forth when the customers went to our store. Mm.
And was it like an automatic, we got it?
Yeah, kind of, yeah. I mean, building the brand is hard. Building the brand is easy within ourselves, but building the brand and really communicating it to the customers and them getting, like us aligning on how we are and what they think we are, took a little bit of time and took a lot of like consistency on our end to make sure that we're always taking care of them.
Yeah.
And we're always giving them the best possible products. We're always making them feel good.
But that's very hard, Steffi, because you know it, right? You know it, you know what brand is all about, you know what you have to put there, but the connection.
Difficult.
Very difficult.
Yeah. I guess it's really consistency. We talk about culture a lot in our stores and in our branches and with all our staff. We actually have culture training. So the new staff that come in, we go through culture training where we really teach them, this is how it is here. Mm-hmm. Yes, you've probably worked in a lot of other places before, but in Lola Nenas, this is how we are. We actually value our values. We actually mean it when we say these are our values. Mm-hmm. And maybe some of them in the beginning are like, is it really like this? Mm-hmm. But we really do try to have this coherent culture, whether you're in the headquarters all the way down to our branches. And I feel like, and I hope our customers feel it.
Mm. When you talk about the brand though, how much of it is Lola Nena and how much of it is you?
I think Lola Nena is me. Lola Nena is every person in our company. Because of this culture that we have, every single person that wears the shirt with Lola's face represents Lola. We talk about this in our training that the customers don't know whether it's your first day or your 10th day in the job. The moment you wear the Lola shirt, the moment you give the box with Lola's face in it, you represent Lola Nenas. Mm-hmm. So I think it's me, it's our staff, it's our production crew, it's everybody. Mm. It became like this, Lola became all of us.
No, we mentioned your dad, Kit, a while ago, but your mom, Happy, also a real force behind you being an entrepreneur and all that. Tell us about the training. Tell us about the guidance. Tell us about the words of wisdom that they gave you up to this very point.
Well, my mom taught me how to eat, and we sell food. Our products are made by my mom. Every single item that we sell, most of our items that we sell are her recipes. Till this day, when I feel like, oh, I want to add something in the menu, I'm like, Mom, can you come in, please? We need you to make something for us. Her cooking has magic.
It does.
Her cooking has magic, mm-hmm. and I think people feel that. And it's nice. It's nice to see that people enjoy her food. Mm.
But how do you know when it's time to add? How do you know when it's time to make that phone call and say, Mom, come in?
I always try to call her. I'm always like, Mom, can you come in? Mm. But we always try to add new things to the menu. You never really know if people are going to like it. So we try to add things. If people have good reviews on it, we keep it. If not, then we try something else. It's really figuring out what people like. Mm-hmm. what I like is not necessarily what people like. Mm. So it's like, what do our customers, ano ba yung pumapatok sa panglasa nila? Mm-hmm. And figuring that out and adjusting as we go.
But even if, okay, so I mean, that's sort of a given, right? That you have to figure out your customers, you have to figure out your audience. But because it's family owned, you gotta figure out the family dynamics too.
Right.
So how was that? I mean, I think a lot of our viewers as well, maybe they're part of a family business, we don't know, but you know, for your family, for example, how did you figure out the dynamics and say, okay, this is the path that we're gonna tread on?
I think it's mutual respect. Our parents really treat us like partners. Especially my dad really treats me like a partner. And so when you have respect for each other, you really listen to each other's points of view. Mm. And if someone says, no, this is what we should do, then everyone will say, okay, even if other people don't agree necessarily, we're all gonna go in for that final decision. We're gonna forget everything else and we're just gonna go. Mm-hmm. And I think having that respect for each other is the most important part of that, is respecting and then trusting each other's opinions. Mm-hmm. At the end of the day, my dad, if he says something, we're gonna do this, then okay, we're all gonna do it. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Or if I say, Dad, I really feel like we should do this, like my gut tells me we should do this, mm-hmm. he says, okay, I trust you, let's do it. So it's really that.
Mm-hmm. All
it's
right.
not as hard to have a family, to be in a family business if you really respect and trust each other.
No. You know, there are a lot of stereotypical notions, but you did say a while ago that it's only now that you really realize that you are a woman leader, yes, but first and foremost, you've always just considered yourself a leader. But what about the stereotypical notions that you're young, you're a woman, you're not capable, not to be taken seriously? Did you ever have to contend with that, and how did you have to rise above it?
Definitely in the beginning. In the beginning, as somebody that looked even younger than I did 10 years ago when I was starting, I felt the need to have like an iron fist. Like, people will respect me if I just, everybody needs to follow rules. Mm-hmm. Everybody needs to do this. But as I've matured in my position and in a leadership role, I'm kind of embracing empathy more.
Yeah.
I'm embracing understanding where people are coming from more. I'm embracing the fact that it's important that I know people's intrinsic motivations, because that's the only way that they would actually want to do what I'm asking them to do.
Empathy goes a long way,
right? Empathy goes a long, long way. And so those are the kinds of things that I've embraced more. Mm. And I think that's like what a woman leader is and what a woman leader should be. You know, embracing the things that are natural to us.
Mm. Let's talk about, you know, going through this path, building the business, building the brand. Earlier, we're talking about your values and all that. You were talking, 2020, you had 60 employees. Now you have 600. But what gives you pause? And conversely, what gives you fuel as you build that brand? Because it's not all like charged, right?
Yeah.
It's not all, we're gonna go after it.
Yeah.
There are some points where, you know, you have to take a pause from it all.
Prayer. Prayer gives us pause. We've been praying a lot lately. Things have been happening in our lives, and we've been leaning to God more and really figuring out what God wants us to do with the brand, mm-hmm. and figuring out like what is our purpose really. Yes, we're serving this good food. Yes, we're communicating this brand to the customers, but figuring out what the actual purpose is of Lola Nena.
That's very interesting, because some entrepreneurs would stop at that. See the profit come in and that's it. But you're going beyond that.
But
why?
There must be a reason, right? There must be a reason why we're given this chance. There must be a reason why in 2020 we were given that break. And there must be a bigger reason. So it's pausing to figure out what that is. I'm not sure exactly what that is yet, mm-hmm. but it's what's giving us a little bit of a slowdown. And like, whatever that is, we're gonna make our decisions towards that. Mm. That's what's gonna steer us.
Tell us about the moments of doubts and fears and how you were able to move past it and beyond it.
There's not much anymore. There's not much doubt.
In the beginning?
And fear. In the beginning, a lot. Especially right before the pandemic, right when the pandemic happened. Right when the pandemic happened, again, I said we had 60 employees. We had no idea how long it was going to be. Mm. And all those employees are counting on us to make sure that they're going to be okay. Mm-hmm. And so that's the reason why we never close. And I think thinking about our employees and not closing because of them was the reason we were given that break. Imagine everybody was closed. Mm-hmm. We were the only ones that stayed open in March 2020. Mm-hmm. But because we stayed open, people had no choice but to order from us.
No, and I saw it, right? I saw it first. You were taking in orders from, I think, a messaging app.
Receiving the orders every single
right.
day.
Right. Yeah. So, and when it was too cumbersome already, then it became your mom, and then all of a sudden there was like you partnered with food delivery services already.
I was calling my neighbors and saying, "Who's not doing anything? Can you come to my house and take orders for us, please?" It was at that time when people would message us on Messenger, and then we would be like, "Okay, you can get donuts 3 weeks from now."
Right.
And at that point, too, a few weeks in, people were complaining that our donuts didn't have enough cheese. And because of those complaints, you were like, oh no, are we going to lose all our customers? But because of those complaints, we were able to get the triple cheese donuts.
Uh-huh.
And so it's kind of like every time there's a problem, we just stop, listen, what can we do? What can we do to adjust? And it's always been good. It always ends up being okay.
How was the reaction when you knew that you were taking orders not just for personal consumption, but because these orders were on their way to loved ones and frontliners and all those who really mattered at the time when the pandemic was raging?
Super surreal. Surreal. And whenever people from other countries would take photos of like, "Hey, I was walking down the street in Australia and I saw a Lola Nana's box." We call it Lola Nana in the wild. You found Lola Nana in the wild. That's something that I never imagined would happen. Mm. And that happening just solidifies, well, the hard work, of course, but it solidifies that we have something that could be something big. Mm. And we have to do everything in our power to sustain it and make it better and make it bigger.
Mm. And talking about that, having an entrepreneurial mindset, I think, Steffi, can be both a blessing and a curse, because on one hand, you do want to strike a balance between aggressively growing the business, but also on the other hand, being so conservative as well, because you want to safeguard your gains.
Yeah.
So how do you strike that balance?
We've been working really hard on creating a good team. And as much as, you know, if I say now, oh, I can open 100 branches, but without a good team to really run it, we can't do that. So what we're doing now to really balance that is we don't open until we have people that are right. So we're constantly hiring for people. So if anybody's watching and would like to apply, we're constantly hiring for good people that can help us grow the brand. And so it becomes hire the people, open a store. Hire the people, open a store, because that's the only way that you can safeguard the quality, safeguard the service. Mm-hmm. Because you can grow as much as you want, but if people don't have a good experience when they go to the store or the brand gets diluted, sayang. Mm.
All right, and finally, before we let you go, as we celebrate you this Women's Month, I want to find out from you, who are you celebrating? The women in your lives, who are you celebrating this month?
100% my mother. Oh no,
I know.
Definitely celebrating my mom. Mm. She is Miss Carmina. She is the rock of our family, and I can't think of anybody else better to celebrate but her. Mm.
All right, and if any of you have met Happy Santana, Steffi's mom, you know exactly what she's talking about. Steffi, sorry.
Thank you. It's okay.
Sorry for making the tears flow, but
it's
thank
okay.
you. Thank you for joining us today.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for blazing the trail. Thanks a lot. Steffi Santana there, one of the remarkable women we honor this month.